Recording, awesome.
All right, everyone, welcome to the September meeting of the Philly PowerShell user group. Tonight we're going to have Mike Fall. Is it Fall or Foul?
It's Fall, you got it right the first try.
Awesome, glad to hear. We're going to have Mike Fall actually give us a talk on exploring SQLPS and the SQL PowerShell module. Mike Fall? Fal is a specialist in data management technology, a community advocate, public speaker, and blogger. Mike is a practicing thought leader for data and automation. He's passionate about the DevOps and data, building platforms optimized for tech and use data efficiently. Since 1999, Mike has been working in the database field, focusing primarily on SQL Server and specializing in automating data solutions to improve the reliability and efficiency of the environments. Currently works as a SQL Server consultant for Upsurge LLC. And apparently he's been caught playing trombone in public on more than one occasion, which is very interesting, Mike. So before Mike takes over and gives his presentation, I'm going to go over a few links. I normally save this for the end, after the speaker, but since I'm not there and I have to be somewhere at 7, I wanted to kind of go over them briefly. So I'm pretty sure everyone's kind of heard the news about PowerShell going open source. Not open source in a sense, we discussed it briefly in the last meeting. The big announcement was basically that they released a version of Linux that does a lot of really cool stuff so far. Still a work in progress. Tons of great articles on PowerShell.org. Let's see if I can bring some of these up. Oh, I sent myself an email. So definitely, if you haven't already read those, check those out. Oh, and also on Fox Deploy. Steve Owen, great blogger as well, has a really good article on it. Don Jones has a ton. Oh, sorry, some PowerShell magazine. Oh, PowerShellMagazine.org had a really great article. I think I wrote this one. Who wrote this, by the way? Why can't I find it? Looks like just posted by. One of our previous speakers, Bartek. Let's see, bring a few other ones up that I saw, especially from PowerShell.org. I'll put these links in here as well. But lot of really great stuff. Don went on a writing spree that week with some stuff. And actually, one of our regulars, Missy, also wrote an article. I highly recommend you guys read it if you haven't already. If she's there, give her a round of applause for actually being brave enough to actually type up an article for PowerShell.org. So a few things happened post this, which is very interesting, was one of the, on the GitHub where they host the open source version of PowerShell, one of the guys who actually maintains curl and wget for all Nix stuff actually pretty much did a, like, is a bug request, is that the word? Basically that it hit the implementation of the alias for invoke web request, basically was kind of conflicts with curl and wget in regards to a native like Unix or Linux environment. There were some interesting like heated discussions around it, but Jeffrey Snover actually did a pretty good like middle of the road sort of situation saying, you know, there's something to be careful about because people may be already using PowerShell, looking at PowerShell, the ability to remove aliases, and that will more than likely be the way going forward. So it was an interesting kind of like a very long, as you can see here, talk about what should be done in regards to this on PowerShell's use of current Linux aliases in the shell being moved over to actual the Linux version. Interesting enough, also Microsoft later that week, right after announcing the open source version of Linux, did a OMI for Linux. So OMI is pretty much the open management infrastructure. It's pretty much like a SIM. It's pretty much SIM, but for everything. SIM being, SIM, I think, if I'm not mistaken, is also for everything. But this is pretty much what lets you use a lot of this, hopefully in the future, lets you use a lot of the SIM commandlets directly on Linux hosts, which is actually pretty cool. So we'll see how that shakes out, which should be very interesting. Some other quick things I wanted to go over as well was there was, if you haven't already heard, there was a Windows 10 update that broke DSC and broke remoting. Currently, if I'm not mistaken, this is still an open issue. Microsoft promised to have a fix within a week or so, but I haven't heard it being fixed just yet. Basically, it breaks all DSC actions and implicit remoting. And now this is an update to Windows 10 Anniversary. I feel that most people in the enterprise are probably on a deferred channel anyway when it comes to deploying patches, but for those people who have, what's it called, home versions of Windows 10, you're kind of at the mercy of when these come out, because you're pretty much can't really defer patches besides uninstalling them. It's going to probably dump it back on anyway. So that was kind of an interesting issue that came out of this. I'm not sure if it bodes well for the recent announcement for Microsoft to bundle up patches for Windows 7 and Windows 8 and kind of deliver those in monthly cumulative updates as well, considering issues like this where you would want to roll back a patch. But it's going to be interesting to see how this actually shakes out. One thing I noticed last week, if you were using Visual Studio Code with the 0.7.0 version of the PowerShell interpreter, it actually didn't work with PowerShell V2 or V3 running on Windows 7. But that was recently just fixed a few days ago. So if you were trying to use Visual Studio Code and ran into an issue with it not using IntelliSense, or like, forget this and go back to the ISE, hopefully this won't let you scare you away from it and go back to it. Also a good reason why to keep your, especially when using Visual Studio Code, to constantly keep those interpreters up to date. Let's see, what else? I think I have one more other interesting article I came across this week. Some really cool security related stuff. I think it was the same article here. So Sean Metcalf, pretty popular in the security penetration community, did a cool article, well, cool presentation at DEF CON using basically PowerShell to kind of, I think he worked at MacRaver as well too, to get basically system access via, well, system level account access via the event viewer. By like changing something along the lines of a text file in the launching of Event Viewer. Someone was lying, some fucking quote me on that, but it's kind of interesting if you guys are interested in that sort of stuff to read through it and actually go through the whole how they went about it, which is pretty cool. Let's see what else. That is all I have. Had to go over. So there's also stuff. Hopefully I'll give you guys some discussion topics or something along those lines. Lee, does anybody else want to comment real quickly before we kick it over to Mike?
I will just touch on the open sourcing of PowerShell. I think one of the coolest things, if you guys get time to just go through and read all the issues that are posted on GitHub, it gives you incredible insight to what the product team is doing, the decisions that are being made, and you have the opportunity to get your voice heard if you have things that you don't, you know, if you find a bug or you see something that you don't like or you want to change, you have the ability to do that now. It's kind of, I think it's one of the coolest aspects to having it be open source, is that you get this kind of behind the scenes look at what's being done to make the product better every day. So check it out.
Cool. With that, Mike, I'll hand it over to you.
All right, thanks. Let me get my screen shared here. All righty. Okay, cool. Well, thanks, guys, for the opportunity to speak to you. It's a different experience a little bit for me because I'm so used to talking to SQL Server guys and trying to convince them like of the wonder and glory of PowerShell, and now I'm talking to basically a bunch of guys who already get that, and you just want to see some of the cooler stuff around SQL Server. So it'll be fun. It'll be good. So real quick, do the obligatory bio slide here if I can advance. So yeah, as John was reading my bio there, my name's Mike Fall. I'm a SQL Server DBA. I've been a SQL Server DBA for quite some time now. Just a couple things about me. I primarily, in the SQL Server community, I'm one of these people who, again, I'm trying to find that bridge between PowerShell and SQL Server and to try and get more folks, because I mean, you guys probably know as well as I do, this is the future of administering not just Windows now, right? With the announcement of PowerShell going open source and being able to run on Linux, it's becoming, I think, I mean, it's Microsoft's flagship platform for automation and management. But so that's the thing. That's mostly what I talk about. You'll find a lot of my stuff up at mikefall.net where I blog. Some of the things that we'll talk about tonight, plus other just general stuff. I've been talking a lot more, I've been blogging more about Azure recently and some of the like the Azure SQL Database platform as a service offering. Let's see. I have a certification. I'm an MCSC for Data Platform, and I'm an Adara ACE, which is a community award that Adara gives out to basically help me stay active in the community. And I do want to just quickly touch on, you know, John mentioned the trombone thing. My secret shame, as I tell people, is I actually don't have any sort of IT training from college. I went to college as a music performance major. So that's the thing, is I still play I still am active in playing. I play in a community orchestra and a jazz band, and I'm out here in Denver, Colorado. So that's kind of the whole trombone thing there. So with that, we'll dive on in. Let's talk about what the agenda is here. So first off, what is SQLPS? And this is a little bit of a misnomer, because when I first put this presentation together, that's what it was. It was SQLPS was the PowerShell module that we had to use. Oh, pardon me. I knock stuff around. Close my windows so you guys don't have to hear the traffic on my street. Anyway, SQLPS has been for a long time the module SQL Server provides for PowerShell commandlets and PowerShell functionality. And actually back in July with one of the updates to Management Studio, they released a completely, I shouldn't say completely new version of the PowerShell module, but they released what's called the SQL Server module. It's essentially SQLPS with some bug fixes and additional commandlets. And we're going to talk about the differences between the two. We're going to talk about the providers. So SQL Server, the PowerShell module gives you a provider. You guys are probably familiar with it. If not, we're going to talk specifically what a provider is and how it can help us with the interaction with SQL Server. We'll look at commandlets and functions, you know, what kind of comes with the module, what we can use, and then finally, practical use stuff. I don't know how many of you guys actually work with SQL Server or touch it. I'm guessing most of you at least, you know, have some involvement with SQL Server in your environment. But I'd like to show, whenever I show this to folks, I want to say, hey, this is actually what I use it for in the real world. And that gives, I think, a little more concrete value to what's going on. So with that, now again, this next slide here, this is mostly for the SQL Server folks who aren't familiar with PowerShell, because I'm going to throw a lot of code at people. I'm like, don't panic, don't freak out, focus on the code, not the concepts. Now again, you guys are more familiar than your PowerShell user group, so you're obviously a lot more comfortable with PowerShell. But really the important thing here is I don't want necessarily guys to say, hey, we're going to like take screenshots or whatever this the code. All my scripts are available online. I actually have a GitHub repo that we'll have a link to at the end where all my presentation materials are up at. You guys are welcome to go grab them from there and go through the scripts at your own pace. Hit me up with questions later if you are working with something like, hey, what's going on here? But as we go through the presentation tonight, now again with a webinar, it gets a little weird, but I'll take pauses for questions, but also feel free to just, you know, interrupt me and say, hey, Mike, we got a question. Can you address something? So with that, we'll go ahead and get started here. You know, the get in the beginning and where do we actually start working with the SQL Server PowerShell experience? You know, it's actually been around for quite some time. I think it was first introduced in SQL 2008 was when they first implemented PowerShell functionality. And it's been around since then, so I guess at this point we're talking 8 years. And when it first came out, it was PowerShell 2.0. It actually, the very first release was a snap-in. It wasn't until later that they implemented a module. And that's, you know, with SQLPS, it was this module called SQLPS that was included with SQL Server. Actually, you know, the strange thing is it's actually not a component you just separately install. It's actually, if you install any SQL feature, you're going to get the module for this SQLPS module. Comes with commandlets in the provider, and I call out here on the slide, it's in SQL 2012 or greater is where you get this module. Previous with 2008 R2, you use a snap-in. Now the thing is I really don't have any necessity anymore to even touch that stuff, because this is all tied to the client tools. You can have SQL 2008 or 2008 R2 installed, but installed at 2012 or 2014 or 2016 client tools and still use the SQLPS module and import module with all that. So that's one thing to always kind of stress with folks is what we're talking about here is it's not dependent on your SQL Server, you know, your core SQL Server version, but whatever client tools you have installed. Now again, SQLPS has been around for a while. It operates on PowerShell 2.0 or greater, and we'll actually talk a little bit about how it actually, in some versions of SQL Server or the client tools, it's actually locked into using PowerShell 2.0. It's actually a little frustrating with that. And that might be one of the things you already have experienced with SQLPS is there's some gotchas to it. It's a little bit clunky. Unfortunately, you know, the SQLPS stuff, the SQL PowerShell stuff hasn't got as much love and attention as like Active Directory or failover clusters or some of the other PowerShell modules out there. Anyway, this is basically how we get started. We start with SQLPS, we import the module, and then we get going. Now, I talked about this a little bit. In July 26, this past July, the SQL Tools team they actually started this back in March of 2016. Where they reached out to the community, and a lot of us who use PowerShell, you know, started bombarding. They're like, hey, we want feedback, and we bombarded them with feedback. We're like, hey, fix these things and update this stuff. We need your help. And they responded. This is, you know, relates to, you know, Microsoft open sourcing PowerShell, doing a lot of the other things they've done. They've become a lot more of a responsive organization, company, to their client base, to their customers. And the SQL Tools team said, hey, we're going to do what we can to make PowerShell better. So with July 2016, they released the Management Studio update there, and they basically reworked SQLPS, and they made it into this new module called SQL Server. Now, really, it contains all the previous functionality of SQLPS. They did a bunch of bug fixes, and then they added some new stuff. And we're going to talk about the differences as we get further along. But this is kind of the thing here is it's great that they're doing this, but it is only dependent if you have that most recent update of Management Studio installed, that July update. And actually, I think if you even get a couple more things if you use the August update. They just released another one. And that's where they're doing all their new work. SQLPS is going to get deprecated. Now, the problem with that is there's a lot of ways that SQLPS is still tied and locked in. We'll continue to talk about this. But again, to get it loaded up, it's import module SQL Server as long as you've got the client tools. Now, as I said, this isn't installed specifically. You can't just go out and say, well, I'm going to install the SQL PowerShell module. I'm going to install some package. I'm going to add a Windows feature. Pretty much this gets installed whenever you install some SQL Server component, SQLPS primarily, but if you install Management Studio, again, you're not going to select, hey, I'm going to install the PowerShell components. It just does it. Now, there are two different installation paths here, and again, this is probably something, again, as you guys with PowerShell are a little more familiar with these patterns. SQLPS has always been installed under the SQL Server directory, so program files x86. SQL Server, the 1.3.0 there that I underlined, that's dependent on the version of SQL Server you have installed. So if it's 2014, it's going to be 1.2.0. If it's 2012, it's going to be 1.1.0. 2016 is 1.3.0. And then tools PowerShell modules, and that's where it dumps that stuff. Now, the with the updates, with this remake of the module, they've gone to the more of, hey, we're going to put this in the standard custom code directory. So it's in program files, Windows PowerShell modules, which, you know, to me, that makes me pretty happy. It's easier to find. It's easier to make use of. So just, you know, some understanding there of where it goes. But other than that, you know, this is kind of the how both managed to get onto your system. Something else also I always like to, you know, introduce people to is how this actually works. Now, again, PowerShell guys, you understand everything in PowerShell is a .NET object. Everything, 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 everything. Well, it's no different with the SQL Server, SQLPS components. Everything is built on the SQL Server Management Objects, the SMO.NET library that's been around, I think it was first introduced in 2002. It's been around for a while, obviously been getting updated and whatnot. But the SQL PowerShell experience, everything some sort of SMO object. Everything is using that .NET framework, which is, of course, a big thing for consistency. Now, again, something I like to point out to the SQL guys is this works when you're working with PowerShell and SQL Server. There's no real voodoo magic going on here. It all works in the same way as many of the other tools that people use. So Management Studio actually also uses SMO. And for, you know, SQL Server folks, they're like, well, I'm used to using Management Studio. And what I'm telling them is, hey, you know, Management Studio, SQLPS or SQL Server, they're both working with SQL Server using that SMO interface, that SMO API. Now, one thing I like to call out is it does require .NET 2.0, which sometimes can get a little frustrating for folks because if I have to add Windows features, I usually have to then go and add that .NET Core framework stuff. But other than that, everything is built on that SMO for that consistent experience. Now, I'm going to hit you with a wall of text. Don't worry about this. I just like to show this because this is all the stuff that gets loaded when I load the SQLPS stuff. These are all the different assemblies that it relies on. And there's a lot there. There's a lot of SMO stuff, a lot of SQL Server libraries, and these all get in there. We'll see how that gets done. But really, you know, there's a lot of functionality. It's this core experience that we're used to using with other tools. And this is just extending into PowerShell. So with that, I'm going to jump into a demo. I want to take a quick pause here. Do we have any questions so far? Okay.
Yeah, we do. One sec. We're coming up to the mic here.
Okay.
David Katz. I have a question that I probably miss what you try to explain. You said, well, this SQLPS module being installed together with a client tool is a Management Studio. I was under impression that this module also available on the server side. Why? Because I saw that's a part. I mean, the whole purpose of this, from my perspective, you write the script for management, script for do other things with a maintenance of SQL, right? And you put it in a on a server machine to run on schedule or do something. As I said, I thought, well, this module is available on the server side more than client side to support whatever script you put together on a server side to run stuff on schedule. So the bottom line is a PS module only client side module, or it's only available on server side?
No, okay, so I'm sorry, I wasn't completely clear on that. You're correct that it gets in, it can be just with the server as well. So going back to, here, let me go back a few slides. When I called this stuff out, when I say it's not installed specifically, anytime I install a SQL Server component, whether it's the engine, whether it's the client tools or whatever, I'm going to install SQLPS. I think kind of more to the point of what I was getting at with it being bundled or talking about the client tools more specifically is I can install the engine at 2008 or 2008 R2 and it will have that version of SQLPS, or I, probably more specifically, let me say 2012. I have SQL 2012. I can quote unquote upgrade, or I can install a more recent version if I install the client tools as well. Unfortunately, I don't have a way to say, okay, I'm going to just install the SQL PowerShell components. But you're correct in that I can just install the SQL Server engine and it will install the SQLPS module for me. The frustrating bit is I can't just install. I can't run an install and just say, I'm just going to install the SQLPS module. I have to install some component of SQL Server to get that module installed. Does that make sense?
Yeah, just one clarification. If I follow you, so all I need, let's say I have box that have SQL Server installed, right?
Yep.
So is that SQLPS module available by default, or I have to install on this box as well?
No, it's available by default.
That's all I need to know. So I can write script, right, utilizing this capability of the, all of this assembly you've shown us, right, on server side, and make this script run on schedule or do whatever.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And we'll look at some examples around that. You know,
okay.
Actually,
you answer my question.
Okay, cool. And just to kind of, you know, complete a thought there, again, this is something that you guys will be a little more familiar with. When we jump into the examples, I'm doing it on my little VM lab, and my SQL servers are actually server core machines that don't have the client tools installed. I can't have the client tools installed, but it still has the SQLPS module available to us. Okay, so with that, let's actually dive into the demo, because I think this will help show.
I have a question also.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead. Yeah.
My name's Dave Dean. You mentioned it is requires .NET 2.0. Does that mean it won't work with .NET 4.0 or?
No, it will work with it. But so one of the things that I always, and this is actually, it has been a SQL Server requirement up to 2016, which I think they're working on undoing that. But that usually means that if you're going to use any of the SQLPS functionality, you have to have that .NET framework core. So you have to have the .NET functionality for 2.0 and for 3.5 installed, as well as the 4.0 stuff.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so let's jump over to the VM. So we're in the ISE. Let me do a quick clear screen here. And this is some stuff that I usually like to show to, again, SQL Server folks to walk them through. Here's where all this stuff is. You know, first off, if we run git module list available, we're going to be able to see what all the different components we have installed. And here, now I have several other things here. So I have the Azure stuff as well as some custom modules. But the things I want to focus on first off is here's the directory of program files, Windows PowerShell, and here's the SQL Server module. So this is the 2016 updated version of the module that's available, and we're on my domain controller where I've installed this. Now, going down here, this is where a previous version, so both versions are on my machine. Now I'm only going to use the SQL Server one for this just as a, you know, just going through it. But really all my examples that we're going to go through work just as well on SQLPS as on SQL Server. So here's where the installation path is for that SQLPS stuff. And there's actually two commandlets in here. We have SQLPS and the SQLAS commandlets. What they've done, this is another fix, is previous to the SQL Server module, we had two modules, one for the SQL Server stuff, which was SQLPS, and then we had these analysis services commandlets. Now, I'm not going to get into the analysis services commandlets, but it was always odd because when I would load the SQLPS module, it would also load the SQLAS commandlets module. There's a dependency there. And just we brought that up to the tools team, and they're like, yeah, it doesn't make sense to have two modules. So they've combined that functionality, and that's gone into the SQL Server module. Now, I do like to show the files in here. So this is a compiled module, right? There's a bunch of stuff. If we load this up, you're going to see we have a bunch of DLLs in the module folder. But, and we also have, you know, our typical PSD1. We don't have a we don't have a module file, so we've only got the data file. But the two files I want to call out specifically here is there is a SQLServer.ps1 file that runs, and then a PostScript file. If we look at these, there's not a lot going on. I mean, we have a big signature block. In the SQL Server file, what it does specifically is it sets a few specific global variables that the PowerShell provider uses to manage stuff. The PostScript file is really what's important here, because what this does is this defines a function for our provider, for the SQL Server provider, and we're going to talk about that and how it works. And then this is important here because we set two aliases. Now, one of the bug fixes they did from SQLPS to SQL Server is these two commandlets were previously, these were actually commandlets, not other function names. And encode and decode are not approved verbs. Now, if any of you guys have tried to load SQLPS before, you might have gotten some warning that says, basically, hey, you've got some commandlets that don't match the naming standards, so people might have trouble finding it. And if you ever saw that warning, it's not that big of a deal because it still loads the module just fine. But a bug fix they did is they said, look, we can't have, it's not good to have commandlets that have that don't match the naming standard. So they created two new commandlets that match the naming standard and then aliased them. So now when we use the SQL Server module, that bug goes away. We do load some assembly stuff. And then, as you can see, it's still got that dependency on the AS commandlets. Now, one other thing that isn't in here, this is a bug fix. If you go look at any of like the SQLPS stuff previous, for 2014 or for 2012, there's also another line in here that does a set location to SQL Server. So some of you guys, again, if you've worked with this before, you might have loaded up the module, and as soon as you import the module, it automatically drops you into the SQL Server provider, which is annoying to say the least. And we brought that up, and this is something that, you know, the SQL Tools team said, hey, yeah, that's a bug. We're going to fix it. Now, the problem is if you're, unless you're using the most current version, you're still going to have that SQLPS that when you load it, it's going to drop you into the provider. And you'll find that set location in this PostScript file. Now, personally, I would actually go hack the PostScript file and just comment that out because I got tired of it doing it. And that's something I'm not going to necessarily recommend it to you, but, you know, if that's something you want to look at or play with, go ahead. But that's just some things that, you know, go on that when they load the module, some of the things that set the environment happen in these two files. So with that, I want to go back, and then we'll just load up the module. Here we go. And, you know, it takes a little bit because the SMO has to load, and sometimes that has some resource. It's just got a lot of, it's got some stuff it's got to get in there. And plus, you know, my poor little VM's having a little trouble processing stuff. So we'll give it a bit. See, and there you go. Now, this warning isn't a big deal. It's just basically because I don't have analysis services, so it's loading those analysis services commandlets, and it's saying, hey, you don't have any analysis services on this machine. I'm like, yeah, no, I don't care. We can do the usual exploratory stuff. So I'm going to do git command module SQL Server, and we have a bunch of different commandlets. I think it's at this point with the new version, here, we'll just do, I should have run this together. We'll run the measure object. And we've got 75 commandlets. Previous to this, it was 46. They added about 20 new commandlets with the 2016 stuff. But you can go through and see all the different names. It all makes a lot of sense, right? We've got stuff like get SQL agent job, some availability group commandlets. That was actually a big thing with the 2012 releases. They added a bunch of commandlets for managing availability groups. But this is just, we can use this to do the typical exploration of the module to see what's available to us. And we're going to talk more in detail about these. So that's just a quick overview of the loading the module, getting around in it, where the different files are. Any questions on that before I move on?
No, we're good, thanks.
All right, cool. So next up, I want to talk about the provider. Again, this is a new concept for a lot of the SQL Server folks, but again, for PowerShell guys, you guys are probably like, yeah, well, I normally manage stuff via the command line. What makes sense for me to do stuff on the command line? Well, using the file system. And the provider is essentially just a way to abstract different components outside of the file system, like registry and environment variables and SQL Server, you know, to make them look like file systems, to make them look like directory paths and files and objects within that. And, you know, we can see what those are with kind of these typical commands, right? I'm just going to breeze past this slide because, again, most of you guys are probably familiar with this, but this is kind of what the SQL Server provider looks like. You know, we can get into the drive, the SQL Server drive, and just run a dir command, you know, or ls if you're into that. I actually tend to use ls more than I use dir. But we do have all these are the different components that are going to come up for us, and they all represent different aspects of the SQL Server engine. Now, one kind of standard pattern that we're going to see throughout using the provider is, first off, we've got the provider or the drive, the SQL Server drive that was always going to appear in our path. We have a folder here that represents the different component of the engine. Now, in this case, this is the SQL engine, so we can see it right here. But we could go into SSIS parts of the provider. We can go into policy-based management stuff if we're using that. But this is kind of, this piece here relates to these different components. Then from there, it gets down into what your host name is and what your SQL instance is, because we can have multiple SQL Server instances on the same host. So we always would have the next part of the path is, here's the host we're going to work in, and then under that would be, here's the SQL Server, whether it's default or a named instance. So that's a quick overview. Oh, my boss wants to talk to me. I should have set Skype up to... Let me do that real quick. There we go. Apologies for that popping up. Let's go ahead and jump back into the VM and start talking about the provider. So again, we can see what the providers are by just using git ps drive. And this is going to pull up. After a little bit of work. There we go. We have all the different providers. And so for those of you guys who haven't seen providers or haven't really looked into this, right, we've got our file system providers, we've got a certificate provider, but this is the key piece right here that I'm going to focus on. We have a SQL Server provider, so we have the name of it, the type of provider, and the root drive. And if we were working within it already, we would have a current location set. Browsing this isn't all that different from browsing a file system. So I can change directory or set location to SQL Server. And if I do a directory under it, here's all those different components we were just talking about. So we have data tier application stuff, if you're using that within SQL Server, data collectors, policy-based management, various different items. Now, the SQL engine is where we're going to be working tonight, and this is actually where most SQL Server DBAs are going to be getting into when they're using the provider. So we can change directory into this, and then if we do a directory lookup, this is where things get a little bit odd. So first off, it's doing a warning because I don't actually, this is running locally, or it's doing the initial directory lookup against my local server. And my local server that we're working on, my domain controller, doesn't have any SQL instances installed on it. It only has the client tools. And this goes back to everything's working off of the SMO. The SMO doesn't really have any knowledge of how many SQL instances you have installed across your environment. And it's not going to populate that right off the bat. So this is one of those parts where you have to have a little bit of knowledge of where you're going before you can use it, because You're not going to be able to do things like tab complete or get a full directory listing. Now, I know I have a SQL Server on the Picard instance, so I'm going to just change directory there. And it takes a little bit, but hey, it jumps out there. So it's not really, it knows, or when I go to connect to it, it's like, oh, there's a SQL Server. This is a valid machine, and there's probably SQL Servers here. And actually, if I do a directory lookup on Picard, we'll see that I have a default instance. The only thing is when we get back, when we go back to the start, it just doesn't have any knowledge because the SMO can't really browse out across the network. If it did, it would take a really long time. So we're going to change directory now into the default instance and do a directory lookup. And now we're starting to see a bunch of different items, a bunch of different components. Now, for those folks who have touched or worked around SQL Server, you might have opened up Management Studio. And if you do, you're going to see a lot of stuff in that object browser on the left that look like this. This goes back to that commonality of SMO, that the SMO stuff and the way how it's presenting stuff to Management Studio, we're presenting it in a very similar way. There's not direct parallels, but a lot of this stuff is the same. I mean, heck, we got we have a thing for databases. We have a thing for logins. We have a folder for job servers, a little weird. Job server is the SQL Server agent. But so let's actually change directory down in databases. And again, the thing I stress to folks about the file system, we're just changing directories, right? We're just browsing the file system like we normally would. If I do a directory lookup now I get the databases installed on my SQL Server. We don't obviously get the same sort of information if we were looking at files, but we're basically getting, getting a file or database lookup of everything with one exception. If you'll notice here, I've got this database MSFAdmin and I've got wide world importers. The one thing that isn't displayed is the system databases. This is a way that the provider has been implemented in that any of your system databases or system objects are hidden by default. Now you can display them if you want, but that requires you to use a force switch. So I can do a dir-force. And when I do this, now we're gonna see all my system databases appear along with my user databases. Bit of a gotcha, not really a big deal, but something to be aware of. Now I do, again, stress that everything in PowerShell is a .NET object. So we're going to get item, we're going to get that one database, the wide world importers, and I'm going to pipe it to get member. If I run this, we're going to get a big long list of stuff. So let me move this aside, and then we're going to move up, scroll up here. And there's a lot of properties, and there's a lot of methods. And that's because we're dealing with a Microsoft SQL Server Management SMO database. Now, you can go look up these objects on MSDN, explore the .NET class libraries for them, and it will give you, full documentation on what all these methods and properties. But again, this is the beauty of PowerShell is we're not just working with, like, some strings or something. We have these full, rich objects that we can use to work with our databases and interact with our SQL Server objects. And we can actually make use of that, right? We did the dir and it showed a couple things. Here, I'm going to pull that back up just to kind of walk through what do we got. Well, we've got a name, we've got a status, we've got a containment type, recovery model, compatibility level, and collation. Some useful information, but there's a lot more to it. You can see by just doing the get member, we have lots of other methods and properties. So by using that, I can do a dir. I'm going to pipe it to select object, get the name, the creation date. I'm doing some calculations because the size metrics that they return back are in kilobytes for whatever reason. And I'm just doing some math to convert it to megabytes. And I'm going to pipe it to a quick format table with auto size. But using that directory lookup and leveraging those methods, suddenly I can use directory lookup to say, give me my databases and when they were created and how big are they? And this can be extremely useful when you've got a lot more databases and you want to go across multiple servers. We can further drill down, you know, if I want to jump in and say, hey, what do I get for the tables? And there's, you know, a directory listing of all the tables in this database. Now, these are SMO table objects, so I can start to leverage the methods and properties of those table objects, and so on and so forth, right? We're just browsing a file system, we're doing directory lookups, nothing crazy, nothing out of this world on that. Now, DBAs will come to me and say, well, hey, I can get all that from doing like a select star from sys.databases or what have you. And I'm like, well, yeah, that's great, but then you're doing it on one server. This is, again, awesome thing about PowerShell is we can leverage these same patterns and start going across multiple servers. So I have two servers in my environment. I'm going to put them into an array, and then I'm going to do a little bit of, you know, take that array, pipe it to a for each object where I do a directory lookup on that provider path with passing the SQL server name, instance name, into the path. And then for each of those, I'm just going to do a select, and it's very similar select to what we were just looking at. I just added a calculated property or calculated column for the server name, for the parent name. But other than that, we're just using that same lookup. And now if I run this, using the provider, I can get show me all my databases across all my servers, when they were created, and how big are they. And this is where I say, how cool is that to the SQL Server guys? Hopefully you guys think it's cool too. I mean, this is the way the provider can help us start to gather information and see what our environment looks like and do it through PowerShell and start to build scripts and automation around this. You know, we can start to say, hey, show me all, there's properties for last backup dates. So we could very easily build scripts to say, hey, find me any databases that haven't been backed up in the last 7 days and back them up for me. You know, all that sort of stuff, all that great automation. So that's pretty much using the provider, kind of getting our toe in the water there. Now, I do want to call out a couple gotchas with it. First off, timeouts. One of the things that a lot of people tend to stub their toe when they start using the provider is timeouts within the provider. Again, if you're used to using PowerShell, you're probably used to tab completion, and we really don't get to do that. And even if we try to, sometimes it's going to time out. And that's because it's using the SMO, and the SMO is trying to query out to database objects. And if there's anything like that gets in the way there, or maybe we misspell something, it's going to fail on us. And it's going to fail after probably about 30 seconds, because that's the default .NET timeout value. And that can be very frustrating to people. So it's just one of those things, though, to be aware of. And I think if you're understanding of that gotcha, it can be okay to navigate. We talked about tab completion and IntelliSense. You know, if we're working within the provider, it may not have all that information cached, so it can't necessarily populate or do tab completion when we're working within the provider. So one thing when you're working with that, it's like sometimes you got to type the whole thing out, which can be a little frustrating. And then this is a weird one with the contextual behavior. When you're working within the provider, it thinks you're working within the SQL Server provider. And then if you try and do something that's a file system operation from that SQL Server drive, it's like, well, you're trying to do like a new item. Normally, if I'm doing a new item, I'm going to create a directory or a file. Well, if I use that within the context of the provider, it's thinking I'm going to try and do a new item on a database object, of which most of them haven't even been implemented. And it's going to throw out ugly red text. So just be careful where you're working with stuff if you're in the provider. Usually, unless I'm working explicitly with database objects, I put into my scripts, I switch back to some file system drive or file system path so that I don't have any issues around that context. So that's just quickly blowing through the provider, touching on it. Any questions so far on that?
No, we're good.
All right, cool. Well, then next up, let's start to talk about commandlets and the different commandlets that are available to us. Because this is really where the provider is great for gathering information. And I use the provider a lot for driving many of my scripts, you know, building collections and using that to process different components and actually building reports, right? If I want to just do a quick directory lookup of stuff. I showed you that two-line pattern where I can go get all my databases and their sizes and the creation dates. So that's all very handy, but really when we start wanting to get stuff done, we want to get into the commandlets. Now this slide, I haven't updated quite yet with the new 2016 stuff. It's in the presentation and we'll look at it, but with the 2014 and 2012 versions, you're going to see about 45 different commandlets. I've broken them out. These four different categories are my own personal categories. This isn't a Microsoft thing, but these are just how they made sense to me. And if I'm going to talk to other people about them, like, this is how I think people should think about how these are. So we have almost half of the commandlets are dedicated to availability group management. There's a lot of PowerShell around, and I actually have an entire presentation where I'm spinning up SQL Server instances with PowerShell and DSC, and I think it's pretty cool, very handy stuff, and I'm leveraging these different parts. There are 10 commandlets for general purpose stuff, for just working with SQL Server, working with different components, at least with 2014 and 2012. Now, when they first introduced the PowerShell stuff, they had this idea, you know, that was when they were really charging hard with Azure. So they implemented a couple commandlets specifically around working with SQL Server on Azure VMs. Now, these are clunky. We're going to talk about why they're clunky. And I don't think I don't see people using them just because they don't really behave how people would expect them to. And then finally, there's some commandlets around doing backups and restores. And those are actually some of my most used commandlets because being able to automate and script out SQL Server backups and restores from PowerShell is just, it's very useful to me. So let's first talk about the general purpose commandlets. This is just a quick list of them. Again, like I said, there's only 10 of them. Of these, I did call out the decode and encode SQL name. Now, with 2016, with the new SQL Server module, they renamed these. So they're now convert to encoded SQL name and convert from encoded SQL name, I think is now. I have to go back and look at the exact name. And these become aliases. But if you're using anything previous to the 2016 version of the SQL Server module, you're going to load these up and you're going to get a warning message when you load up SQLPS about these two commandlets. Again, they load fine, everything's in there. The warning message is simply, hey, by the way, somebody might have trouble finding these because they don't match the naming standard. I do like to call out just a couple useful commandlets. So invoke policy evaluation is handy for folks who use policy-based management. It's just a way to be able to go invoke these policies and evaluate them against remote servers from PowerShell. And that's a task that usually people will tend to automate. Invoke SQL CMD is like the workhorse for me. This is, if you've worked with SQL Server, you're probably familiar with the SQL CMD command line utility. It was introduced with SQL 2005, and it's just a command line utility for executing SQL Server queries against SQL Server. It does give you an interactive mode. Well, what they did with PowerShell with this is they gave you this invoke SQL CMD commandlet, which allows me to execute SQL against SQL Server. So I can build query statements, pass them to the commandlet. The one big difference between this and the original SQL CMD command line is this is not interactive. Invoke SQL CMD is purely fire statement off, return information. Now it can return data or it can process data. We'll look at it a little more in detail, but it's one of the big ones to me that I make a lot of use of. The rest of them can be used in specific use cases. Now the backup and restore stuff, unsurprisingly, we have two commandlets for backing up SQL databases and restoring SQL databases. They do pretty much what they say and they take many of the parameters that get used for doing SQL Server backups. We're going to look at them in a lot more detail as we get into the demo. I always like to call out the smart admin stuff because people probably look at that, particularly SQL folks, are like, what the heck is smart admin? So in SQL 2014, Microsoft introduced the capability to back up your database to Azure Blob Storage. So it's called backup to URL. Very handy technology. I use it for a couple of our clients. It's a great way to say, I want to offload my backups to the cloud. That way I get kind of globally redundant storage and I get the infinite, quote unquote, infinite scalability of the cloud. You know, of course, they'll charge you for however much you want to scale it out. But it's handy to say, look, I don't necessarily want to keep my backups, or maybe I want to duplicate my backups up to the cloud. Well, this smart admin was another addition to this backup URL where Microsoft says, look, we're gonna, you can turn this feature on where you can just say, I want my database to be using what's called managed backups. And what SQL Server then does for you is it will back your database up to the cloud on its own. You just say, you know, this, I want this database to use managed backups, and it will at least once every 7 days, and sometimes more frequently, depending on what the logic and the algorithms say, will back your database up to Azure SQL Store, Blob Storage. And it will also do log backups if that database is in full recovery mode. And you don't have to configure any schedules. You don't have to build any jobs. It just does it. And it's actually pretty cool. Now, me as a DBA, I'm a bit of a control freak about my backups, so I'm a little leery about using it. But certainly for like small POC databases or something we're just getting started, or maybe you know you're stuck with this and you don't have a lot of time to manage it, managed backups can be very handy. And the PowerShell commandlets, the long way back to this, is these smart admin commandlets are used to manage, from a PowerShell perspective, manage these managed backups. So this is kind of what we have to work with. Now, the cloud management ones, I just want to touch on them. Again, I don't use these. The first off is all these commandlets require what's called the cloud adapter service. Now, the cloud adapter service is a service that is installed by default to all Azure VMs. It's there. It's already running. So, again, these commandlets were intended to be used only with the Azure VM stuff. You can install into an on-premise machine, and that would allow you to do some of this stuff. But again, I look at these commandlets, and I often wonder why these were even created. So we have add SQL firewall rule and remove SQL firewall rule. Well, I've already got add net firewall rule and remove the net firewall rule. So I already have PowerShell commandlets to create and manage firewall rules, so why do I need one specifically for SQL Server? In addition, the SQL Server ones, the problem that I have with those is they create a rule that opens the firewall to the executable, to the service, but they don't. I can't define ports, I can't define communication protocols, I just open it up and it opens across all my firewall profiles, whereas with the net firewall rule stuff, I can define, okay, this is on the domain profile, this is on the public profile, I've got a lot more control. And it goes through the rest of these, right? They all kind of work the same way. I have commandlets for start and stop SQL instance. Well, I use start and stop service for this, so I'm not really sure why. I usually call these out just so people are aware of them, but I don't use them, and I don't really think anybody needs to. Finally, these are all the commandlets for availability group management. We're not going to talk about these because there's a lot of them, and it's a very advanced topic. Well, I shouldn't say very advanced. It's a more advanced topic, and I have an entire presentation dedicated to just this. But, I like to show the folks there and say, hey, this is what's out there. You know, just be aware that they're there. Now, I talked about the 2016 stuff. This is all the stuff that was added back in July. Now, always encrypted is the big to-do right now with SQL 2016. So they added 18 different commandlets for managing always encrypted stuff. Pretty cutting edge, and actually what's kind of nice is if you're going to be using this stuff, you're going to be on 2016, which means you'll already have the current stuff. You don't have to worry about whether or not you have this on previous versions of the SQL Server module, but they're there. They did add some commandlets for managing the SQL Server agent. You'll notice they're absent in the previous version of, or the previous slides that we were going through. So these can be handy for, you know, figuring out your job, getting your job history is kind of a big one. But you can manage stuff around SQL Server agent jobs using these commandlets. And there's probably more to come around this. You'll notice they're all gets. There's not any sets or news around that. Finally, they added a couple commandlets for managing the error log. This is actually pretty huge because I mean, I could read in my SQL Server error logs before using the SMO, and there's some methods around that. But having the having just a straight up commandlet that's very simple for me to call is very handy for me to basically read in my error log and parse it and start to build automation scripts around that. So this is kind of a really neat addition. So I've kind of flown through that. Before I dive into the demo, I'll just take a quick pause. Any questions?
Yeah, sure.
Sorry, is there a question?
Yes. My question about, you showed a few things, especially I was impressed that from the script, you can go against other machine and to do stuff against them, right? So let's say, again, my point or my interest is in automation. So if I'm going to use those scripts, I'm going to put them on schedule to do things. So with that said, if the script is doing something against other machine, right, in a cluster or, you know, cluster of different installation of SQL, what kind of account should run this PowerShell module or PowerShell script in order to be able to access some remote machine?
Okay.
I mean, what's from your perspective? Because you said that as far as you said UDBA, you probably met this kind of challenge.
Right, right. Okay, so security basically is what you're asking about. How do we manage the security and how do these interact with SQL Server from a security standpoint? So everything that we've done in the demo basically runs under my account. And that account has to have SQL Server permissions. So whatever session the PowerShell script is running under would also have to have some SQL Server permissions. And depending on the level of work that it does, it's going to need the appropriate SQL Server permissions, whether it's maybe, maybe it's sysadmin, I need to have access to one database. DB creator, if you're going to be doing database restores, that specifically what permissions would be assigned within SQL Server is a much larger topic. But really, to come back and try and answer your question, what's going on is where whatever context that script is running under is the permit. That's the account that it's going to be attempting to run its SQL Server actions under. And that account basically has to have SQL Server permissions assigned. Now, what I tend to do when I'm building my PowerShell scripts, my own personal experience is, if it's some sort of automated script that's doing certain tasks, particularly like I said, if I'm maybe doing some database restores, or for example, I have a script with a client that basically does log shipping using the backup to URL functionality. That script runs under the SQL agent service account. So I already know that that agent service account has the permissions in SQL Server, and it is a service account that I can manage. Now, there's obviously, I've got to take some care, because if I put whatever script I put out there, if it's running under that service account, I better be damn well sure about what's going on in that script. But my own personal experience is I'm just going to make sure I have a service account that this is going to execute under, and that service account has the appropriate SQL Server and operating system permissions that it needs to do to get its tasks done. Does that answer your question?
Yes. Yes, it does. Just a quick one more. I don't want to interrupt for a long time. By default, when you install SQL, this account will be kind of local account, but is there any way you can say, okay, this is a, you know, account that you have created in Active Directory, so, and that'd be a agent account, so you can easily assign different kind of permission, right, on that operating system or even another machine as well, right?
Sure. So you have a couple different options there. So first off, if you have if you put your SQL Server automation into a PowerShell script, you can have that script run under the Windows Task Manager. And in Windows Task Manager, when you create a task, you can set the Active Directory account that's going to run those actions and use it that way.
You answered my question. Thank you.
Well, there's another option. The other option, we're not really getting into it. Let me pop over to the demo machine just to kind of touch on this. I don't really demonstrate it in this presentation, but I want to make you aware of it because there's a second option. You can put PowerShell, you can have a PowerShell job step when you create SQL Server agent jobs. And while we're doing this, let me fire up. Let's see here. There we go. Zoom, it's running. Okay, so if we go into the SQL, the other way that you can do this stuff is you can have a SQL Server agent job running your PowerShell script. So I have a backup user databases, and if I go into steps, here's my step. Now, without getting too much into the details, this is a PowerShell script, right? I've put a PowerShell script into my SQL Server agent, and the things I want to call out here is, there we go. So I have a job step of PowerShell, and then it's running as the SQL Server agent account, and I can change that to use if I have a credential set up in SQL Server. So you have two different ways to approach it. You can do it as a Windows task, or you can do it as a SQL Server agent job.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah, thank you.
Sure. Okay, cool. All right, well, let's go. Any other questions before I jump into the demo? All right, excellent. So again, commandlets, we saw this before. We can get a list of all the commandlets and see how many there are. Now, I always like to just do some basic demonstration. I'm going to use the Git SQL database. Now, we saw before where I was able to use Git item, and I can use Git child item as well, to get a database object through the provider. But I can use Git SQL database, declare a SQL Server instance, and the name of the database, and return the SMO object of the database. So these are two different ways for me to get at that SMO object, and this is where the Git SQL database commandlet can be somewhat useful to us. Now, I also like, this is one of the cloud ones, the Git SQL instance. I'm not going to actually, I am going to run it. I do run it because this one is a little weird. Most folks would see Git SQL instance and go, hey, this is going to give me an SMO object. It actually doesn't, and you'll notice first off it throws up a credential window. And the reason it's doing this is it's trying to use the cloud adapter service to use a Windows administrator account or an account that has administrative privileges on the server we're going to target to get information about that SQL instance, and it returns an IAAS object. This is just one of those I like to show to people because it just, you know, you want to have a little bit of care working with these commandlets because sometimes they do weird, like you'll run into one of these weird ones. But really, let's make use of some of this stuff. Let's do a backup. Now, backup SQL database, very handy command. Like I said, one of the ones I heavily use. And it takes a few parameters. So we have a SQL Server instance name, in this case, Picard. I'm going to have the database that I want to back up, which is Wide World Importers. I've got a file path to a .bak file, so this is my backup file that I'm going to create. Now, just so you know, this path that we're declaring is local to the SQL Server instance we're running it on, just as if we were going to run a T-SQL backup command or right-click on Management Studio. If we're declaring a path, it's going to be local to that SQL Server instance, not to the machine we're running it on. I'm going to do an initialize, and that's the thing is this commandlet has a bunch of different switches that all go back to different options for running a backup command. Now, the one thing I also like to call out here is I'm going to use the script switch. Now, this tends to be a bigger thing for the SQL Server folks. I don't know if it's going to be for you guys, but I'm going to run this backup database command with the script switch. And when I do that, first off, let me get down here, just clear screen, just so we've got a clean screen. But when I run this, first off, it's not actually running the backup. It's giving me the T-SQL script that will execute the backup for me. So a couple key things here is, one, we're using the SMO, and the SMO is how we're generating this script. This is the exact same sort of script we would get if we went into Management Studio, you know, said right-click, backup database, wide world importers, and then there's a button in the upper left that says script this action. And if you clicked on that, you would get the same script. So SMO, because we're working through the SMO, the PowerShell commandlets, and any other tools that we use to manage SQL Server working in the same way. The second thing is, you know, this is a good way to say, hey, I just want to see what I'm going to do before I actually do it. So we get this way to generate a script for us that could be either, we can either run it manually in Management Studio, or if we remove the script switch, we'll just run the backup. So now if I'm going to, whoa, apologies, getting away from me there. So I'm going to go ahead and run this. And it's going to come up here. It's got to get going here. Yeah. And we get, the nice thing about this is it gives us a little progress bar on the backup for the database. And this could be something we can very easily implement into any number of automated scripts, right? You can put this into loops. You can put all sorts of dynamic parameters. We're actually going to look at an example of how we can be a little more dynamic about the backup command in a bit. Now let's talk a little bit about using the commandlet for running SQL statements, invoke SQL CMD. So first off, I'm going to create, here's just a here string with a SQL statement. I'm going to do a select from sysserver principles join to sysdatabases. This is going to give me a count of databases by database owner. Now, people often will come to me and say, Mike, well, okay, we got invoke SQL CMD, which here I'm going to just, I'll put this into the variable, and we're just going to run the command without assigning to a variable yet. And it's going to come back with, here's our query result, right? It's just going to output the query result as our columns and our values, our rows. Nothing, not really rocket science, but a lot of SQL folks will come to me and say, well, I've already got SQL CMD as a command line executable. How is this different? So I'm going to walk through this by assigning the outputs. We're going to use the same SQL statement, but we're going to assign those outputs to variables. And when we get done with that, if we look at these outputs, so first off, let's look at SQL CMD. Again, here's our output. We've got our columns and our rows. Obviously, the first thing that jumps out is the formatting is way messed up. If we do the same output or look at the same output, you'll notice here with the invoke SQL CMD, it's a lot cleaner. And why is that? Well, we're dealing with two collections here. And so I'm going to take the first item of each collection and get the type for those. And what we have is for the SQL CMD, we basically have a collection of strings. Whereas for invoke SQL CMD, we're getting data rows as our output. And this is important because now what we can do is, you know, we go back and talk about how PowerShell gives us these rich .NET objects to work with, and we get this robust information about our objects and all the data assigned to it. When we're working with data rows, we can now flex those instead of doing, like, for example, if I had outputs here, if I want to do it with SQL CMD, I got to do a lot of string parsing, and I'm actually getting all the header rows. If we go up here, these header rows are actually, like, this is the first element of my array. This name and DB count, that's the first item of my array. These dashed lines are the second. Whereas in the data row output, the SA is my first item, and the Starfleet my fall row is the second item of my array. And I can actually even get more so by saying, hey, let's do invoke SQL out. If I want to call the name property, it's just going to give me the stuff in the name column. Whereas if I wanted to get that out of the SQL CMD output, I got to do string manipulation and a bunch of stuff like that. So the invoke SQL CMD can be very handy, but the real strength of it is the fact that we're getting this rich object-aware output coming out of it. Now, so that's pretty much just a quick, you know, jump on some of the commandlets, kind of what's going on there. What I want to do next is, we're going to get into a little more of the commandlets when we talk about the practice we use, but I do want to jump back to the slide deck real quick and talk about a few of the gotchas. So first off, these documents, again, if you're used to using PowerShell, these commandlets, you know, you're probably used to going doing git help, right, and getting a nice help file around your commandlets. Well, the SQL Server commandlets are not documented as well, but this is getting better. I've actually, when I first was putting this together about a year ago, the documentation was in a pretty poor state. The SQL Tools team has come a long way, and a lot of the commandlets now have some fleshed out help files, and there's online documentation that you can find, whereas before it wasn't there. So I call that, you know, I'm saying, hey, just keep an eye on this because it's getting better. Unexpected behavior, we sort of saw that with the get SQL instance, where some people might, you might expect one thing and end up getting another. So be a little careful with using these commandlets, maybe do a little bit of exploration around them. But, you know, once you get, I think once folks get through a couple of the, you know, using it for a bit, it's not that big of a deal. And then lack of support. Again, this is changing. The SQLPS module up until March of this year has languished in near obscurity. It's been kind of a discarded stepchild as far as the SQL team has gone. They've been focused on other things. Well, come March of this last year, the SQL Tools teams, again, I kind of keep coming back to this, but you know, they reached out to the community. They're really making an effort to make this experience better. And there's a lot of bug fixes coming along. And there's even more commandlets that are going to be coming in the future. We actually have, you guys may or may not know of Chrissy Lemaire, who's a PowerShell MVP out of Belgium. She's kind of leading the charge of working with the SQL Server Tools team to identify what needs to be fixed, to prioritize it, and to push the SQL Tools team to improve this whole experience. So the thing is while I talk about these gotchas, the good news is these are getting fixed and improved and will really help folks. So any questions on that so far? I know I'm kind of flying through some of this stuff. I want to get to the practical examples, though.
No, we're good, Mike.
All right, cool. So with that, you know, I don't even know why I have these slides because really all we're doing is we're jumping back to the code. So practical use. This is like stuff that I've actually started to use the provider for as well as the commandlets. Now we saw this, I did this sort of server instances collection before. This is a pattern I tend to use. Now you can use anything to build your collection, right? I'm here explicitly declaring a string array. But you could, you know, read in a, like maybe you have a text file of all your servers and you can read that in. You could use invoke SQL CMD to read in from a database table all, like maybe you have a database table containing all your servers that you want to query against. So you can use that to build your collections, however you want to do it. So I'm going to create these collections. Now, like one thing as a DBA, folks will come to me and say, hey, what are we doing with our SQL versions? Where are we with patches and cumulative updates and service packs and all of that stuff? Well, that's where this next line here comes in pretty handy. I'm going to use the provider to basically print out a report or display a report of all the SQL Server versions in my environment. And it's that pattern we saw when we were talking about the provider before. I've got my instances. I'm going to pipe it to the for each object, and I'm going to use get item on the path of the SQL instance. And then I'm just going to select name and version string. And with this one line, right off the bat, I can see now I have on both my SQL servers in my environment, I have the same version of SQL Server. And in this case, it's the RTM of 2016. So you'd have to, you know, the one trick of this is I have to relate the build numbers to what the actual build is. And there's plenty of resources out there for it. But if I had 20 or 30 or 50 SQL servers and I want to see, you know, what are all the different installations looking like? I can use this one line, as long as I build my collection right, to go across and get all of my servers. Now, we sort of saw this before with the database backup we saw it with the create date and the database size. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a column or a property called last backup date, and I'm going to use the same pattern where I'm going to, for each instance, I'm going to do a lookup on the databases in my provider path, sort it on size descending, and then give me the output. And so now with using the provider, I can very quickly see here, okay, I've got three databases, here's my different servers, the different database names, and they were last backed up on these dates. So I probably need to back up this AdventureWorks database on my Riker server. But this is one of the cool things is first off, it's pretty easy for me to use the provider to dynamically figure out, you know, where my backups are and how big my databases are. And then I can start to, you know, then further take this, build additional collections to run my backups, to identify which ones, maybe send me out alerts if I'm building scripts around that. You know, a bunch of different options that we can use to leverage this information. So that's using, you know, just getting some information with the provider. Let's start actually automating some tasks. So for example, I want to run a backup. Let's say I want to backup all my system databases across my environment. Now I already have my instances collection, right? So I'm going to use this to drive things. And I'm going to basically do a for each loop, and I'm going to go through each instance. And for each instance, I'm going to use the provider to get a listing of all my system databases. So I have to use that force flag. And then I'm further going to do filter where system object is true and the name is not equal to tempdb. So for each server, I'm going to basically get my master model and MSDB database names. And then for each of those, I'm going to pipe it to do a for each object, backup SQL database, server instance. And then I'm going to back it up to C backup. So I'm going to back it up to the C drive local to that server with this path, the C backups. Now we could add other stuff to this where we could say, well, I actually have other scripts where I dynamically check for, you know, does the backup path exist? Should I create it? Maybe I have old files once the backup's cleaned up. But really the key thing here is I'm going to, with this, you know, this loop of code, I'm going to run this, and actually it's this that just says, hey, you know, I'm going to run, and as you see, I get a bunch of progress meters. But now when I do a directory lookup on each of those instances, I've, with that one script, here on Picard, here's the three backups that I just did. I am in Mountain Time. It's 7:22 for you guys, right? And then I did the same thing for my Riker database. And I can build this to run from one location and back up everything across my environment as long as I build that instances collection correctly from the get-go. And again, we can add more stuff to this. I've got, like I said, I got scripts that, or I got some of these, this pattern where I include a line to say, does my directory path exist for the backup? If not, create it. To format the backup file to have a nice date time string in it, lots of different automation options. And all we're really, the core here that we're using is that backup SQL database command.
Mike?
Yeah?
I have a question. This is very good practical implementation of this capability. But I'm wondering, I like the way you do it across the server with a unified ask to store those backups. But, you know, some databases can be pretty big, right, if
sure.
you run full backup. Now, when I see the picture, I mean, the progress bars, they kind of three bars simultaneously. Does that mean that this kind of approach uses so-called asynchronous? You just say, hey, you do the backup of database X, right, and go to another, and backup started. So you don't have the script. Does not wait, right, until actually backup completes to move to the next, or it's waits, it kind of do it sequentially.
Okay, so two things there. So first off, this is not an asynchronous command. So by asynchronous, right, it would, we'd say run the backup, and then the backup, you know, the script would keep, would proceed, and the backup would be running off in the background. That's not what's going on here. When we call the backup SQL database commandlet, it's going to process the backup, and the session will just basically, you know, be running that commandlet until the backup is complete. Then it will move on. So, and then this is serial operation, right? So what we're doing here when we go through this loop is we're going to run, this backup gets run on the first instance for the first database. So with backup, like on Picard, we back up the master database first. Then on Picard, once the master database backup is complete, then it would move on to the model. Then once the model is complete, then it would move on to the MSDB. So it's got to go through, and it's going to back up each one serially. And you're right. With some of your larger databases, this could be a problem because the other databases aren't going to get backed up until the big one gets completed first, if that's where it's at in the processing loop. Now, that being said, because it's PowerShell and we're running these through Power, if I was doing this in T-SQL, I wouldn't have a whole lot of option around that. I don't have, unless I, you know, build separate jobs and have separate T-SQL commands, I can't just do it from the same script. Because it's PowerShell, I can use either PowerShell background jobs, which I've done in the past, to fire off parallel backups running, or I can use run spaces. You know, and I've not used run spaces personally. I just know they're out there, and I think Bo Prox is the MVP who's done the most with run spaces, if you want to do more research on that. But there's things that we could build in our PowerShell script to run the backups in parallel across one server. The caveat, or the big thing I would warn you about if you're doing that, is backups can very quickly, if you're running a lot of backups at the same time, can very quickly choke your IO path, you know, your storage paths for your IOs on your SQL server. So if I kick off like 10 backups all at the same time, I could very quickly saturate my IO pipe and bring my SQL server to its knees. So be very careful if you're going to build some sort of automated process to back up databases in parallel. Be very careful and try and maybe consider some throttling or some sort of, you know, logic around, okay, well, I only want to have 3 or 4 backups running at the same time. It's a much larger discussion. This is just kind of a simple example, but there's a lot of different ways, because we're using PowerShell, that you can deal with that. Does that help? Did that give you what you're looking for?
Yes, that's the question. And I like the solution because it's just targeted a set of those system databases. They're primarily not very big, but yeah, you will be sure that there will be, you know, backup on daily or whatever the basis from the little partial script. It's very good practical application.
Okay.
I'm very happy to learn this capability exists.
Excellent. Cool. No, I'm glad this is what you're looking for. I mean, this is, like I said, this is what I tend to use a lot of this stuff for. And in fact, continuing with the backup theme, one of the things as a DBA that I always struggle with is if I've got a full recovery, a database in full recovery model, building out my point-in-time restore script can be very tedious. So for those of you not aware, if I got a database in full recovery mode and I want to restore to a certain point in time, I have to go through the backup chain and I have to restore everything through that. So what I have to do is I have to start with the most recent full backup. And then I have to, if I have a differential, I can apply one, but then I have to get all the log backups from that starting with that full all the way to my point in time. This can be pretty tedious if I'm like, as a DBA, I back up most of my SQL, my full recovery model databases, I back them up once every 15 minutes. So you go, what, like 15 minutes, that's 4 per hour. 4 times 24, that's 144. I'm not doing math right. Anyway, that's a lot of database. That's a lot of backups over a day. Just one 24-hour period. And then, you know, if I got to do that across multiple days, I got a problem. So this could be very tedious, and I want to be able to do this pretty quickly. This is where that restore SQL database command that can be very helpful, because it also has a script switch, and we can do this a couple ways. Now, first off, I'm going to do a quick change in location to the C drive, because I'm going to do, because I'm going to be doing a couple file system operations, I don't want to, you know, screw up my context. But I'm going to first do a lookup on where my backups for YWorld importers are, and I'm going to do a star.bak, and I'm sorting by last write time descending. So I want to get, and then I'm doing select first. So basically I'm going and saying, give me my my most recent full backup. You know, just let's start there. The next collection I build is all my log backups. So I'm doing a directory lookup, star.trn, so all my transaction log backups, and then just doing a filter saying, I want everything that has a last write time since the last full. So only the transaction log backups that have been made since the last full got made, and then sorting them by that last write time, because I have to restore these log backups in order since the full one. So I have to do, you know, it all has to be in chronological order, or else it's not going to work. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of, just a real quick thing on the move files. If I want to put the files in a different location, I have to use a relocate file SMO object. This is just the way the commandlet takes stuff. So I'd be able to collection that says, here's my data file, and here's the physical path that I want it to be moved to. Here's the log file. Here's the physical path that I'm going to move it to. You know, this is one of those, take it apart, look at it on your own time. It's a little tricky, but it, once you kind of make sense of it, it's not too bad. So I'm going to create a collection of where I want my database to be restored to physically, and then I'm going to give it a new database name. So what do we have? We have one full backup file and then a collection of other backup files. Let's just run this, make sure I've got this, because I think I might have jumped over that. So I've got that. I've got my database name. Now I'm going to leverage some loops and the restore SQL database script or commandlet to build a script. I'm going to call that. I'm going to give it a name. I've got the database name, the relocate file collection, so where I'm going to physically restore the database files to, the backup of the last full. I'm doing restore action database. Now, I have to do this all in no recovery. This is just how the restoring the point in time works. You basically do everything in no recovery as you continue to apply backup files until you get to the last one, and then you fully recover it. But then I'm going to script, and I'm going to pipe that to outfile ctemp-restore.sql. Now, this next loop, I'm just going to go through the log file collection, and for every log in there, I'm just going to check and say, am I in the last log file? If it's not the last log file, I'm going to do the restore with no recovery. If it is the last, then I just do a normal script out. So what does this all give us? You know, I've got basically what? I think like maybe 15 lines here, might be including comments and white spaces. But when I run this, this is going to build my script for me. And access to path denied. Oh, why must you be like this to me? I have a demo fail. I apologize. I think I have that file out there. Let's go to ctemp. Yeah, so this is from a previous time that I ran this. I apologize why the script doesn't work. I'll have to go back and review why I'm getting an access. I probably just got a bad file path name or something. I'm not going to spend time troubleshooting this. What happens, though, when I run this, I get this restore.sql script. And if I open this up in SQL Server, as you can see, I now have all my restore statements. So if I had, look at all these log files I'm going to have to restore. You know, that's a lot of stuff. And if I have to manually type those out, that's going to be a real pain in my butt. So this is a real quick way for me to put together a restore script for point in time. And this is one of those patterns where I like to write scripts to create scripts. So for me, this gets me about 90% of the way. And I might need to go in and tweak this for my particular restore situation. But this is where PowerShell and these commandlets can really save my butt in getting me through this restore process, particularly because, you know, there's a lot of times when I'm restoring a database in an emergency and I got the CTO breathing down my neck that, you know, I don't have time to sit there and putter with stuff. If I got a script like this, it can save me a lot of grief. So anyway, this is some practical stuff, like I said, that I've used before. I use this point-in-time restore stuff all the time for building restore scripts and migrating databases. There's a lot of other things that you can do. So with that, any other questions on just kind of some stuff that I've used here?
No, no, good, Mike.
All right, cool. Well, at this point, I'm ready to wrap up here. So these are the things we talked about. Hopefully, at this point, you understand what SQLPS is, also what SQL Server is, how you can use it, how you can get it installed, how you can leverage the provider, you know, as a way to gather data, to browse SQL Server as if it were a file system, you know, the commandlets and the functions. There's only so much I can talk about in 1 hour when you got even 45 or 70 some odd commandlets, depending on what version we're talking about. But there's a lot there, and it's worth exploring. Like I said, there's some gotchas to it, but you know, if you're aware of those, you can find some real gems in there. And then we talked with the practical use stuff, right? We talked about the practical aspects, you know, things that I've actually done with the SQL PowerShell module and ways that I've automated my environments. So with that, I just want to leave you. Here's my contact information. If any of you guys have questions, so email me, mikefall@mikefall.net. My blog is at mikefall.net. So if you have an interest in some of the other things that I've done around PowerShell and SQL Server, plus some of the things we've talked about here, like I blew through Invoke SQL CMD, showing you very roughly what it can do for you. But I've got a full blog post on how to use that, how to manage it, what it can do for you. I'm on Twitter at Mike_FAL. If you guys want to follow me on Twitter, want to interact with me there, that's great. And then, again, I'm a consultant. I work for a company called Upsearch. We SQL Server Professional Services, you know, mostly focusing on SQL Server Engine, SQL Server Administration. We have some remote DBA services. If there's something that you saw here and something that maybe you're like, hey, I need a real sharp SQL Server guy or a couple SQL Server guys, because I'm not the only one there. There's a couple other people I work with that have been working with SQL Server for a very long while. But reach out to us, upsearch.com, connect with us. Happy to, you know, have a conversation if there's something we can do that will help you out. And then I talked about GitHub, right? So my GitHub repo is github.com/MikeFall. You'll find there's one specific repo for all my presentation materials where you can get this slide deck and the script, you know, the demo script if you want to piece through that. Plus, I've got all my other PowerShell SQL Server scripts out there. The one thing I will always caveat is there's a lot of work in progress stuff out there. There's some things that aren't, like, I'm still working on polishing up, you know, some little snippets and things. So, you know, you're welcome to, you know, go there, explore, grab some scripts, play with them, see if they can help you out. But just be careful and test them. Certainly test them very far from production before you even think about getting them over to production. Because I don't have a lot of money, so don't come suing me. Anyway, but yeah, like I said, I'm big about sharing stuff. So please feel free to take a look at those scripts and see if there's something in there that you can help, that might help you. Other than that, I'm done, guys. Thanks again for your time. And any other questions that I can answer?
Yeah, thank you, Mike. We do have a follow-up question.
Sure.
Probably a few. Yeah.
Hey, Mike.
I can't really hear you if you're talking.
Oh, where am I supposed to be talking?
Oh, that's better.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now.
Okay. All right. Hey, thanks again for all of this. It was very helpful. Do you have any experience with using PowerShell desired state configuration to either build net new or reconfigure existing SQL servers? And if so, do those PowerShell DSC resources use and utilize these PowerShell modules that you're talking about today?
So I think they use a little bit. I do have some experience. I'll be honest. I've struggled using the DSC resources, the ones from Microsoft, because there's some clunkiness to it. And I know some other people who have had better success with them, and I want to talk to them. Actually, there's a guy named Sean Melton, M-E-L-T-O-N. He's doing some stuff right now around the DSC stuff. But essentially what they do is, if you're using the DSC configuration stuff, what all they're doing is they're building out a command line install that calls SQL Server, the setup.exe with all the appropriate command line switches to install SQL Server. Because it's doing that, what I tend to do for my own SQL Server installs is I have a config.ini file, and the only thing that I pass through is I'll pass through credential objects that, you know, will set the service account password, so I don't have to store those in plain text. That's usually how I approach it. I'll use DSC to set everything else up, so active domain controllers, failover clusters, get everything kind of configured as far as the base machines go. But SQL Server install, I don't tend to use that. I'll use the standard command line install with config.ini.
Understood. Thank you.
Sure, no problem, man. Any other questions? Did somebody say something? Because I didn't hear it.
How close do I need to get? Can you hear me?
That's great. That's perfect right there.
All right. There's a distance of about 2 inches that makes all the difference here. Does the SQLPS module run on Linux?
It does not. To my knowledge, it does not right now. None of the SQL Server components have been ported to Linux yet. A couple things on that. So first off, that's all dependent on the SMO, the .NET libraries, the SMO. So I don't believe those have been ported yet. It's in the process, right? Because Microsoft is building SQL Server to run on Linux. They've got a preview version that I think they've got running on Ubuntu. But that hasn't been released to the wild yet. And they're still hammering out the bugs. I think once they do that, you probably will have access to that functionality. I don't know. But this also comes back to the open source nature. Something we're trying to get the SQL Server team to do is to take these modules and do the same thing with these modules that they did with the core PowerShell engine in getting them out into GitHub and open sourcing them. But as of this time, no. And hopefully, though, in the future here.
Okay, thanks.
Sure.
Thank you so much for a lot of information. For me, most interesting, and things I can use practically start tomorrow. This is a backup system database, the way you shown, and I very much impressed with your solution on a point in time. I mean, this is a good stuff.
Oh yeah.
I'm gonna go and use your generosity, and use your script, and I will be very happy.
All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate the kind words. I would also say, if you're looking for stuff, I mentioned Chrissy Lemaire. Check out, there's a PowerShell tool set called DBA Tools, and I think you can get it at dbatools.io. I've contributed to this project. Chrissy's written a bulk of it, but there's a lot of utilities there for managing and migrating SQL servers and doing a lot of different tasks around it. And we're growing it all the time. So if you like some of this stuff, check that out as well.
Awesome, Mike. Thank you so much. John and I will be in touch. We'll get your address, send you a thank you package from PhillyPosh.
Oh, that's not... Okay, well, I appreciate that. You don't need to, but, for me, as you can probably figure out, I like talking about PowerShell and SQL Server, and I just really appreciate the opportunity to talk with you guys.
Awesome, man. Well, we appreciate it very much. Thank you for your time.
All right. Thanks a lot, guys. I'll go ahead and then bail off, and I'll let you guys do the rest of your thing.
All right. Sounds good. Have a great night.
Hey, you too. Thanks.
Yep.